Despite not as many anime coming out as normal, I still found a number of shows that I really liked. Plus, with fewer shows coming out, that meant I didn't get so far behind on everything. Granted, I also wasn't as into trying everything out as normal, so I did not go out of my way to watch everything, but still, I had a lot of fun with the anime. I'm not going to talk about the shows I did not finish this year to basically save on time and editing so this video isn't 5 hours long, though I kind of like making those videos. But they will be on the screen if you're curious what shows I dropped and why. So, there you go. Also, for a show to be on this list, the season must have completed this year, so as much as I may like ReZero, I'm not going to rave about it here. I rave about it in plenty of other videos. And for a series to get my Anime of the Year spot, the series as a whole must be complete, which actually disqualifies like 80% of my list. Though I'm curious if anyone can guess my Anime of the Year based off those two conditions. Actually, pause the video and comment what you think it will be. I want to see if anyone gets it right. Plus, comments are good for the YouTube algorithm, according to certain Pokemon YouTubers I like watching. Alright, let's get on with the list. At number 11, we have Rent-A-Girlfriend. Okay, I lied, this is a top 11 list because I finished 11 shows this year. But it was either, like, make the list a not even number or complete 4 other shows, and it's already past New Year, and I actually don't want this to come out in March, so yeah, we're doing 11 here. Sorry about that. The show, though, is honestly pretty bad. I wanted to drop it, and I would have if I wasn't doing a weekly podcast with a couple friends. Over on Everything Anime's channel, go check that out if you're curious. Basically, though, it's a show about a guy who gets a harem of girls through a rental girlfriend service. It's like your standard harem romance. It had some potential, and there are parts of it I did legitimately like. It explored the ideas of loneliness and just wanting to improve yourself in an interesting way at times, but also felt like none of the ideas went anywhere, and anytime some progress was made, it was just like for the sake of drama, and then it was reset by the end of the episode or the arc. It feels like the show is just going in loops, adding drama for the sake of drama because they needed something to happen, and then it ended incomplete. Though, unlike some of the shows, we have a season 2 announced. Though, why is this the one getting a season 2 when there are so many others? Well, more podcast content for Everything Animated, so I guess that's something. And I get to be part of it and do stuff with a friend, so I guess that's good. Yeah, the show itself, not so much, though. Then at number 10 is Tower of God. I really did like this one quite a bit at first. I found the world interesting. I liked learning about it through the main character's eyes, whose name I forgot. I want to say it's Belle, but that's Danmachi. I need to see that season 3. Anyway, it's after looking up, it was apparently Bam, which explains why I thought it was Belle, since they're kind of similar, but whatever. I did like Bam going through the world, learning more about it, and it was just cool seeing it fleshed out over time. I also liked the cast of characters for the most part, though around halfway through the season it became kind of boring, or like it was getting through events because it had to instead of because the events were interesting, if that makes sense. I'm not exactly sure of the cause, though hearing from manga readers, it was rushed, like they were doing too much too quickly, but it felt like there's so much going on without any of it being interesting. Though I did like the part with Rachel near the end. That was interesting. And while this could be like a rough but decent enough start to a good series, it ended incomplete without any sign of a season 2. So, yeah, it's really pointless then. So it gets this spot on my list. Then at number 9 is Magia Record. Speaking of rushed, this is a Madoka spinoff, and it was interesting at times with the weird city, the whole salvation of the magical girls, and all that. Plus, the art was really cool, which sets the mood so well. Like, you can tell just by looking at it, it is more Madoka. Though the series itself seemed disconnected. A lot of characters are introduced just for the sake of it, and while they were okay, it didn't feel like we really got to know them. And again, the show ended incomplete, especially on a cliffhanger. I think they said something about a season 2, but it's been nearly a year now and no sign of new news, so I'm going to count this one as incomplete. So again, decent start if we get more, but as it is, another disappointment. And speaking of disappointments, at number 8 we have Fates Denied Heaven's Feel. Yeah, that review is controversial, but I stand by the claims that I made there because the final movie was a letdown, and it brought the whole Heaven's Feel trilogy down. Simply put, it felt rushed, at least the last movie, so it wasn't able to land the big emotional moments that it was supposed to. A lot of the character arcs felt unfinished, the battles were overly flashy at times, and the final twist at the end made no sense. I know a lot of this is explained in the visual novel, but if an anime requires knowing the visual novel to explain it, then it is not a good anime. But speaking of good anime, at number 7 we have Sword Art Online War the Underworld. The best SAO yet. I know I say that every season, but it's true. Every season is a step up from the previous one. Granted, it's normally not a big step up, but it's still something. And this season in particular does a lot with whole isekai storytelling and then pairing that with interesting themes in a sci-fi setting. Story-wise, the arc solely focuses on the war between the human empire and the dark territory within the underworld. Giving so much focus to the war lets the show really focus in and hone in on what's going on, and I like that. There are a lot of interesting characters and all the different sides to the battle and what they're fighting for. And one of the things I really liked is how this is set up to be the big finale to the series, bringing back a number of characters from previous parts as well. And I like the greater ideas of the season too, how the bonds we form in video games really do matter. Sure, it is somewhat pandering to its audience, but I think it makes a good argument, and it even uses the power of friendship in some really cool ways with Kirito. It is Sword Art Online, and it still has the problems that SAO has, like Kirito getting too much of the spotlight, some events happening just because they need to, and so on. But it was some of the most fun I had with anime this past year, and I like the ideas here of friendships formed across great distances because of how well it fit 2020, or at least 2020 for me. In fact, I almost made it my anime of the year. As I was getting near the end, I thought it would be cool to have a tie at number one between this pick and SAO, because I like coming up with surprises for my number one anime. And what bigger surprise would there be for me to pick SAO, like the most cliche and target for hate in the anime community? That would be a great way to reverse expectations. But then we got to the end, and I thought it was going to wrap everything up in a satisfying way. But no. 2 episodes in, I saw it was not wrapping things up. In fact, I was left bewildered and in awe at where the story ended up going. And I don't know if that's bewilderment in a good way or bad way, though I am definitely curious. I want to see where they go next with that idea. But then it just ended there, and there's no sign of more anime. So that leaves SAO among the many decent but incomplete anime, and much lower on the list than it would have otherwise deserved. And speaking of incomplete anime, we have number 6, Talentless Nana. This is one of the shows I talked about every chance I got because I like it that much. Plus, it feels underrated. It's like a hidden gem or whatever. And it is one of my favorite new anime of the year. It's about this class of people who have superpowers, a main character who doesn't, and the enemies of humanity that they must face. And there's a lot of focus on suspense and mind games, and they are done so well. The show is amazing, but another incomplete one. Yeah, that's the trend here. I need to go find the manga for this one, though. But for now, let's get on with the rest of the list. And at number 5 is Standing on a Million Lives. This one was special, partly because it actually had a season 2 announced, so I don't hold it against it not ending completely. This is good to see, and it has a lot to like, too. It's an isekai, though different. The characters go back to Earth after each quest they do in the fantasy world, and instead of just forgetting about their old lives, their old lives are a big focus in what they're going through, and it creates some very interesting dynamics. The characters have who they are on Earth affecting who they are on the fantasy world, and while we don't see much of them on Earth, you can definitely tell the impact that the journey is having on them. And I also think the main guy is really interesting, a bit overly edgy at times, but in a way it works, and it sort of fits when you consider like he's a teenager and all he's been through. I'm really curious where the story will go, and some of the foreshadowing is very exciting, especially if they go in that direction. While not a part of the show itself, I think the name is cool and evokes some great imagery. All this led to me enjoying the first season quite a lot more than I thought I would, and I'm hoping I will enjoy season 2 as well. Alright, for number 4 we have A Certain Scientific Railgun Season 3. This season was so much fun. I love how Railgun feels like a classic anime, partly because it is, but also because it is filled with cliches of anime like action, slice of life, comedy, fan service, all the things you expect from anime. Like, this is anime, and I love anime, so I love this. This season we got the fantastic festival arc, and I loved how it expanded the cast and let some side characters shine while also digging deeper into the greater mysteries of the show. Then of course there is a Dream Ranker arc, which was very weird at times, but again, I love the ideas here they explore with like science as a whole. Railgun is an anime. That's probably just the best way to describe it. It may seem a strange thing to say, but if you've seen it, I think you'll understand what I mean. Then at number three is My Hero Academia. It seems crazy that it's been like nearly a year since season four finished, but what a season that was. The thing about MHA is not that it's groundbreaking, but it's how it knows to craft a story done before. And I am hooked every single arc. The overhaul arc was fantastic, really nailing what it meant to be a hero and the challenges here, but also just the importance of it, how being a hero may seem impossible, but is still worthwhile to pursue. And I especially loved how well Miria represented this, and we just saw his dedication, how it wasn't just to save someone's life, but to save their heart as well. And we also saw this with the festival arc, which I liked because of how different the arc was. It was much more down to earth and allowed for a more human look at the characters and the world. It may seem weird to say, but MHA is one of the most emotional anime I've seen, and this emotion is just filled with hope, which makes it constantly one of my favorite anime of all time. And so I'm looking forward to season 5 as well. Oh yeah, and Endeavor's arc at the end, while only 2 episodes, was also extremely satisfying to see. Yep, season 5 will be fun. Only a few more months. And now for number 2, we have Fruits Basket Season 2. Yet another show that destroyed my emotions, but in a good way. Fruits Basket is a show about humanity, both the good and the bad. And I love how at the center of the show, the brokenness of all the characters are. These are good people fighting as best they can, but in a cruel world. But they fight anyway. And I love all the instances of the characters coming together as best they can, all in their own ways. This season in particular saw so much growth for the characters in their relationships, like Ayumi and Yuki, and along with Kyo and Kagura, and then like Yuki with all the other characters as well. I am so excited to see how the show all comes together. Though I will be sad to see it over for sure. There really aren't a lot of shows about Fruits Basket, and that's what makes it so amazing. Alright, here we are, the top of the list. Despite there not being many shows this year that I completed, there's a lot I enjoyed, though most of it was a continuation from previous years, which is great in a way. I like getting more of a show I enjoyed previously because, well, who wouldn't? But sometimes I want something I've never seen before. Something different, something weird, something where I don't know what to expect. I want something new. I want something brand new. So it is only fitting that my number one anime of the year is Brand New Animal. Yes, I have to come up with some sort of pun every year to introduce my number one pick. And I'm glad Brand New Animal won. That was a good pun. And no, I did not make it number one just because of the lead-in I came up with. At least not completely. It's mainly here because it's the only complete show I actually liked. But in all honesty, it did a lot that I enjoyed. It's about this human girl who develops a case of Beastman-itis, which turns her into a Beastman. And after being mistreated by humans, she escapes to Anima City, a city where Beastmen can live in peace. At least in theory. While there she meets other Beastmen, makes friends, is betrayed, and learns about the people here and how they live. What makes this show so interesting is how it explores so many different ideas, all based around the idea of the other. It's not simply saying discrimination is bad either, though that's a piece of it. It shows how those deemed lesser are abused by those in power, but also shows the cycle of victimhood, how some will do anything they can to grab some amount of power, even at the cost of those who you would think they'd want to support. Then there are some interesting ideas about religion too, plus idols, both in the religious sense and the music sense, at the same time. Yeah, this one was definitely weird. But with the current state of the world, I feel it's a very relevant show. The story itself is interesting too, though it's the exploration of the city and the characters along with the ideas that really make it stand out. So that was my list for the year. Let me know what you thought of it, shows you thought I missed, shows you think I should check out. Because I like it when people tell me what I should watch, though it goes on a list I never get to. A lot of times. Give me a good reason though, and I will watch it. So yes, thank you for watching this video, and I will see you all next time.